on the ground power.
Copy. Ground power is now on.
1, 2, you're up.
Affirm. You're good to go.
Yeah, should be. I'll check once the getter started. Let me know when you're ready for taxi.
We'll go.
Pull up. Altitude.
1, checking Fox Mike.
Lima Charlie, you me?
Same. Okay, 1 is ready to taxi.
Roger. My HSI is fine again, so go ahead and contact ground. Let's move on and continue where we left off. You still have those waypoints we introduced earlier in the second flight plan?
I messed things up playing with them while waiting for you. I accidentally deleted the train flight plan, but added waypoints to the original one we had.
Alright, then take your time and rebuild the second flight plan using the waypoints from the knee board for me. Remember about closing the rectangle by adding the first waypoint at the end, okay?
Right. On it. And done. Train flight plan is ready.
Good. Contact ground when ready. 2 is already up.
Roger. Tonopah ground, Tusk 1 is 2 A-10s at Bravo Ramp, ready for taxi with Charlie.
Tusk 1, Charlie is current. Taxi Bravo, Foxtrot, Alpha, hold short runway 32 at Alpha. Contact Silverbow on 257.9.
Bravo, Alpha, hold short of 32 and Silverbow on 257.9 or Tusk 1-1.
Chief, turn off the ground power.
Copy. Ground power is now off.
1, taxi out. One, pushing silver bow frequency. Silver bow, Tusk 1 flight, holding an alpha, ready for departure.
Tusk 1, Silverbow. The winds are 230 for 5. Cleared for takeoff, runway 32.
Clear for takeoff, runway 32, Tusk 1.
Kermit, after takeoff, turn right and push to our waypoint 5.
Roger, right-hand turn towards waypoint 5.
Tusk 1-1, Silverbow, clear to resume on navigation. Contact Blackjack at 377.8.
Blackjack on 377, escalate Tusk 1. Thanks for everything.
I have no idea why they chose that name, but I do know a little bit about Silver Bowl.
Then indulge me.
It was one of those short-lived mining towns that popped up and grew like mushrooms in the beginning of the 20th century. Well, maybe mushrooms aren't the best example, but you get the gist. Anyway, the settlers thought they found even better deposits than in nearby gold fields, but they were wrong about that. Silver Bowl was abandoned only 1 year after it was created. Now, it's one of the many mining ghost towns gathered in the desert.
Is it open for tourists?
I guess if you have authorization to enter the Tonopah Electric Combat Range, plus a good four-wheel drive, then yeah.
Huh. For the time being, I'll limit my activities to the petting zoo you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, it's totally worth it. As we're getting back on range, stand by, I'll contact Blackjack. Push 377.8.
Done.
Blackjack, Tusk 1.
Tusk 1, sidecheck, send it.
Tusk 1 is a two-ship of D-10, 10 miles to the southeast from Tonopah. Looking for re-entry for a local fan flight.
Test cleared and carry your dispersion. All ranges should be clear.
Clear for entry, Tusk 1.
Since you're apparently a history major, can you elaborate a little more on the F-117's operations here at Tonopah?
Yeah, sure. So, in the early 80s, as the Trend project was moved over to the operational side, they shifted the entire F-117 program from Groom to Tonopah. The base was pretty sparse, so they had to build it up. They added all the security measures, support infrastructure, dorms, and the rows of hangars that became known as the Canyon.
Dorms? So people were actually stationed up here?
No. Well, most were not in the traditional sense. So they were actually assigned to Nellis, but they would get flown up here on Monday, as then they would get flown back to Nellis at the end of the work week. Keep in mind that the F-117 was a black project until really the spring of 1990. Being black, a lot of stuff was kept in charge figuratively and literally.
I'd imagine. So what did these folks tell their families what they were doing all week way up in the high desert?
The story was that they were doing stuff with A-7s up there.
A-7s, huh? That's funny.
In hindsight, yeah, it's pretty funny covering up what, at the time, was one of the most advanced and revolutionary aircraft in history, which is fluff. So these days, they just keep most of the retired F-117s and Type 1000 storage here, just in case we need to bring them back into service.
If the internet is to be believed, there's still some flying around these days.
Yeah, I saw some. I mean, something about that the other day on the internet. Maybe if it's true, we'll see one. Wouldn't that be something? We're getting close to the live fire ranges where we'll be doing that side of your training.
Yes. I can't wait to get back on the trigger.
I bet. So there's all kinds of ranges scattered around the NTTR, as you'd expect. Lately, they've been keeping us down here closer to base while we've been doing our training. That way, we stay out of everybody's way and we can maximize the time we have on the range versus driving halfway to Oregon and back.
Makes sense.
As we make our approach to the area around the ranges, pay attention to the TAD. Look at how close we're operating to the containers. It behooves you to stay outside of that box unless you feel like catching a major ash chewing at the least.
Copy.
Yeah, copy you. Lima Charlie.
Alright, we are now going towards the north horse base and ranges. Let's have a look at the waypoints and air attributes, and we'll see how they work in practice. Sounds good?
Yeah, sounds okay.
Good. Please pay attention to this part to be quite tricky and rather complicated. I'll try to make it as straightforward as possible.
I'm all ears.
Cool. So each waypoint has a certain set of attributes assigned to it. These can be set either for the flight plan or for the individual waypoints independent of the flight plan. We can view those in a number of ways, but first, let's focus on the flight plan one. Go ahead and put the AAP steer dial into flight plan mode, press the nav button on the CDU, and choose the attributes page.
Okay, AAP steer set to flight plan and waypoint attribute page is selected.
Okay, first attribute is the scale. It determines the course deviation indicator and glide slope indicator sensitivity. Sensitivity is measured by the dots on the HSI and ADI.
Raj.
The second attribute determines the steer mode with four different options. To, from, direct, and SCS. Let's have a closer look at these, okay?
Yeah, okay.
To from is the default setting for the steer attribute. What it basically does is it allows you to determine the desired course to or from the given waypoint using the HSI knob. This is especially useful if you want to perfectly align yourself with the runway or set up on an attack run with a very specific heading.
Okay, makes sense.
Between two waypoints. In this mode, the HSI knob will be used to align the course arrow with the heading displayed on the attribute page for a consistent course deviation indicator, ADI bank steering bar, and CDU position page cross-track deviation indication.
Okay.
Yeah, I know. It sounds complicated at first, but it'll get easier when we do some practical exercises. Direct is the third steer mode. This one is much more straightforward as it sets the course from the aircraft position when direct mode is selected to the current steer point. As with the 2-2 mode, you will use the HSI knob to align the course arrow with the heading displayed on the CDU attribute page.
Right.
And finally, in the SCS mode, the commanded course is a manually selected course away from the point where the aircraft was located at when SCS was selected. So you'll want to set it using the HSI course select knob.
Alright.
Next attribute is the vertical navigation mode, which you can find on the right side of the CDU screen. It has two settings, 2D and 3D. In 2D, only horizontal data will be passed onto the HSI and ADI, so you won't get the steering cues to intercept the waypoint altitude.
Okay, Raj.
Mode allows to have a vertical angle computed either automatically or entered manually. This will then give you the possibility to use also the vertical steering cues of your ADI.
Yeah, got it.
Nice. Let's prepare a few more things and we can move on and do some practical exercises, cool?
As ready as one can be.
Loving the enthusiasm. So first, let's get the hang of 2-2 and 2-from mode. Press FPM on your CDU and press the second line select key on the right, marking the small arrow next to the train flight plan.
Okay, I've done that. I can see a list of waypoints that I've added before. small arrow next to each one and WPTATT text above. Pressing each of the arrows will take you to the attribute subpage specific for that given waypoint or the selected flight plan. Press the arrow next to waypoint 11 or the first train 1.
Done. I've got the whole list of settings that you just described.
Exactly. Leave the scale as it is, but change the gear setting for me into 2-2 mode.
Alright, done.
Perfect. Now press the flight plan menu button on the CDU again. Then enter the train flight plan and do the same thing for all of the waypoints in there. So we're going to leave train 4 as 2 from. Let me know when you've done all that.
Okay, all waypoints set according to instructions.
Very good, now choose train flight plan as our active one and set the waypoint changing to auto. Next, select waypoint 14 or train 4 as your steer point.
Okay, done.
Our aim will be to get there flying a very specific heading, say 270. Currently, waypoint 14 should be somewhere to our 7 or 8 o'clock, which is indicated by the thin arrow on your HSI.
Affirm.
Okay, use the HSI course select knob and set the desired course to 270. Once you've done that, you will notice that the CDI needle has moved away from the course arrow, which is currently pointing directly toward the left, right?
Yeah, that's exactly what happened.
In order to align ourselves directly with the desired course, we will need to first go north for some time. Go ahead and turn heading 360 and keep 270 knots indicated. Watch as the CDI is closing to the center of your HSI, and when it is one dot away, start a 15 degree left-hand turn and try and align yourself perfectly with the steer point.
Alright, I'm aligned and on course.
Great. Now press the nav button on the CPU and select the attribute subpage. In the lower right corner, you'll see that your HSI is set as 4270 or thereabouts. This is a digital readout of what you have set on your HSI using the nav.
Yeah, got it.
Staying on this page moves your steer point up to the second train runway point, the one closing the flight plan. As you have previously set its tribute and it is in 2-2 mode, text is changed and says dial HSI course 256 X-ray. Go ahead and set that course on the HSI.
Okay, done.
As you're approaching waypoint 14, you will see that the CDI is aligning with the course arrow. Try and have it aligned perfectly in the middle as you turn and continue towards waypoint 11.
All right, I think I'm there.
Nice. Prepare yourself for the next turn and move your steer point first down to waypoint 11 and then up to waypoint 12. Check the HSI setting given in the nav attributes page and dial it before reaching your current steer point. If you look at your course arrow, you will notice that it aligns exactly with the green line on the TAT connecting waypoints 11 and 12. So in a way, your HSI is showing you turn in relation to your current course. When ready, begin your turn. Again, try to align the CDI perfectly with the course arrow. If you do it correctly, you will also see on your TAD you're riding the green line connecting waypoints 11 and 12. Let me know after the turn and when you're ready to move on.
1 is on course to waypoint 12.
Good shit. Next rotate, your course set knob left and right. You'll notice that it has no impact on the CDI needle, which remains in place. This is because in choo-choo mode, you'll use the course set to align your course arrow with the desired route. Now return to nav page, press the attributes up page, move 1 waypoint up to waypoint 3, set the course accordingly, and turn when ready.
En route to waypoint 13.
Cool. See that you're riding the green line perfectly? Let's see. Press the FPM button, select the train flight plan, and enter the attribute subpage for waypoint 13.
Okay, I'm in.
Now slowly start to depress OSB 19 or left line selected 1 and watch the CDI. As you change the scale, it should be moving away from the center depending on how far off the desired course you are. If it doesn't move, then that means you're right on it, in which case I can only congratulate you. When ready, turn to waypoint 14. Remember that it's set with a 2 from attribute. HSI will behave differently than before. Your course is set to the previous setting, which was around 77 degrees, and the arrow is still pointing towards the east. Rotate the course set knob in order to align the CDI with the course arrow.
Okay, done.
As you can see, the CDI will move towards the center as you align the course arrow with your current steer point. This is the main difference between the 2 from mode, where you choose the heading you want to use in order to get to the selected steer point, and the 2-2 mode, which can be best described as a line connecting the previous waypoint to the current steer point. point attributes are direct and 3D modes. For starters, once again, go to the flight plan menu page and choose the MSN flight plan as the active one.
Okay, main flight plan selected.
Now press the arrow next to the asterisk under flight plan build. Navigate to waypoint 6, which should be next to position 07, and enter the attributes page.
Okay, done.
Now do me a favor, turn towards waypoint 6 and then set the steer setting to direct. What this does is that when you press it, it plots the course from the position of your aircraft to the selected waypoint. In this mode, turning the HSI knob will not move the CDI, as your aircraft should now follow an imaginary line between the point in which you switch the waypoint to direct mode and the current steer point.
Let me get this clear. So I can set the direct mode beforehand, but the CDU will start computing the course at the exact moment when I select this waypoint as a steer point for the first time.
Exactly. So if you align yourself at the given waypoint and then set the attribute to direct, you will be on the correct course from the outset. As soon as you set the attribute, the nav attributes page will give you the correct heading you need to align the course needle.
Okay, roger. It works as a 2-2 mode, but treats the initial position of the aircraft as a previous waypoint. So, what about the 2D and 3D modes?
Yeah, man, that's it. Let's keep waypoint 6 as our current steer point, press waypoint button on the CDU, and then use OSV 7 or the first line selected key on the right to enter the waypoint subpage.
Alright, I'm on the waypoint subpage now.
Press 6 on the numpad and press OSB 19 or the left line selected key 1.
Done.
You'll see that the elevation is set to 10,000 feet. Go ahead and change it to 15,000 feet by typing it on the keypad, then press an OSB 18 or left line select.
6.
All right, the altitude's now set.
Take a look at your ADI. The vertical steering arrow on the left will be way up, showing you that you need to climb in order to intercept the required altitude of the waypoint. It will give you steering cues similar to the ones used for glide slope on ILS landings.
Cool. Pretty neat. What happens if I change the attributes back to 2D?
They'll disappear. Okay, that's it. Pretty sure it'll take some time before all that knowledge sinks in. Practice it as often as you can and play with the attributes.
Raj.
Just remember to change the attributes for waypoints in flight plan mode. You have to do that via the flight plan menu page. In mission mode, you can do that through the general attributes. In nav mode, or separately for each waypoint menu. Capiche?
Yep, I think I got it.
Good deal. The last thing to remember is that 2-2 mode will only work correctly if you cycle the waypoints up, but won't work if you're going backwards. And with that, we'll conclude today's lesson on waypoint attributes. Let's pass waypoint 6 and keep quiet for a moment, and I need to drink some water and rest my voice for a minute. Waypoint 7, let's talk about the last item on my list for today, which is going to be desired time on target and desired time to go. Ready?
Sure.
Okay, so as the name implies, the desired time on target and desired time to go allows you to determine a specific time of arrival up to within 1 second, or a specific time to reach a given waypoint. These are interlinked, so if you set one up, others.
Roger. Makes perfect sense.
It does, doesn't it? So let's try to use it to cover a distance between waypoints 7 and 8 in a set time. Let's say 5 minutes.
Alright.
Since we are following the flight plan, we'll just have to set it up using the flight plan menu mode on the CPU, just as we would change the waypoint attribute. So please enter in now, select the current active plan, and go to the properties of waypoint.
Okay, ready.
The bottom left side of the screen, you will see the desired time to go and desired time on target value. Type 000500 on your scratch pad. Do not press anything else. We'll want to introduce that value at the moment of passing waypoint 7, okay?
Yeah, copy. Just to make sure I'm tracking. The moment we pass waypoint 7, I depress LSB-17 or left LSK-3 for DTTG, right?
Correct. know when you've done that.
Okay, set.
Sweet! As I've said before, you'll notice that the desired time on target is also changed in order to be in line with the introduced desired time to go. So take a look at your HUD. Below your current speed, you will notice the letter R with a value next to it.
Affirm. That's the required speed and it hangs there from time to time, like before as well.
Firmo, Sherlock. Yeah, sometimes those values are added in the cartridge. In order to get rid of it, you'll need to enter the attribute page and press the LSP or OSP next to the desired time on target or time to go, and it will disappear. Okay, now match your speed with the required value.
Copy.
As you do so, take a look at the right side of your HUD. You can see the remaining time followed by a slash and value with a plus or minus in front.
Affirm.
This shows you how many seconds before or after the desired time you will arrive if you keep your current speed. So if there's a plus, it means you're going too fast and will arrive too early. If there's a minus, you're too slow and will arrive too late. Got it?
Plus if I'm too fast, minus too slow. Gotcha.
Thank you. time's up. Where are you in relation to waypoint A?
One is at waypoint 8. Perfect timing.
Okay, I think you've got the hang of it. That's it for today. I know we're probably supposed to cover some more stuff, but I think it's enough for one day already. Continue with the flight plan. I'll contact Blackjack until you're out of the range. Please ensure you're still on 377.8.
377.8 is set.
Blackjack, Tusk 1 is exiting.
Approach, Tusk 1 is 2 times A10C, north of truck stop, inbound for landing with information Lima.
Tusk 1 knows approach, radar contact. Continue inbound, expect the visual for 2-1 left.
Continue inbound for runway 21 left, Tusk 1-1.
Tusk 1, descend and maintain 5,000.
Descend and maintain 5,000 for Tusk 1. Nellis Tower, Tusk 1-1 is 5 miles out from runway 21 left, full stop.
Tusk 1-1, Nellis Tower, wind is 030 for 10. Check landing gear, clear to land, runway 21 left.
Clear to land, 21 left, Tusk 1-1.
Altitude.
Okay, I'm safe on the deck.
Guys, taxi back to Thunder and I'll catch up with you there.
Tusk 1-1 Dallas Tower, vacate at Alpha. Contact ground on 275.8.
Roger, vacate Alpha. Contacting ground, Tusk 1-1. Dallas ground, Tusk 1-1 is just off 21 left at Alpha for taxi back to Thunder.
Tusk 1-1, taxi Alpha, Golf, Charlie for Thunder.
Taxi Alpha Golf, Charlie Tusk 1-1.